लोकतंत्र दिवस पर आप सभी को बहुत बहुत शुभकामनाएं। आज का दिन हमारे लिए संकल्प का दिन है कि हम अपनी लोकतांत्रिक संस्थाओं को सशक्त और मजबूत बनाएं तथा जनता के प्रति जवाबदेही बनाएं, ताकि इन संस्थाओं के माध्यम से जनता का कल्याण सुनिश्चित हो सके। आज इस अवसर पर विश्व के कई देशों के माननीय पीठासीन अधिकारी जुड़े हुए हैं। मैं उन सबको विशेष रूप से बहुत बहुत शुभकामनाएं देता हूं, बधाई देता हूं। आप सब भी आज लोकतंत्र दिवस पर अपने अपने अनुभवों और विचारों को साझा करेंगे, ताकि हम सब मिलकर अंतर्राष्ट्रीय स्तर पर लोकतंत्र को सशक्त और मजबूत बनाने में अपनी प्रमुख भूमिका निभा सकें। आज पूरे विश्व में लोकतंत्र को ही शासन चलाने की सर्वोत्तम पद्धति माना गया है। अभी कुछ दिन पहले हम वियना में विश्व के संसदों की अध्यक्षों के पांचवें सम्मेलन में मिले थे। वहां हमने कुछ प्रस्ताव और संकल्प पारित किए थे और अपने विचारों और अनुभवों को साझा किया था। मेरा विचार है, उन विचारों और अनुभव के माध्यम से अब हमें अंतर्राष्ट्रीय स्तर पर लोकतांत्रिक प्रक्रियाओं व प्रणालियों एवं लोकतांत्रिक संस्थाओं को मजबूत करने का प्रयास करना होगा। हमने वैश्विक मंचों से जुड़कर संपूर्ण विश्व में लोकतांत्रिक मूल्यों के पोषण, संरक्षण और संवर्धन के लिए अग्रिम भूमिका निभाने का संकल्प लिया है। मुझे आशा है उन संकल्पों एवं प्रतिबद्धताओं को पूर्ण करने की दिशा में विश्व के सभी देशों की संसदों द्वारा साझा प्रयास किए जाएंगे। मैं अब हमारे साथ विश्व के कई देश के पीठासीन अधिकारी जुड़े हुए हैं। मैं सबसे पहले हमारे आईपीयू के अध्यक्ष श्री द्वारते पशु जी के को आग्रह करता हूं कि वह अपनी बात रखें।
Today, we celebrate the International Day of Democracy. It is very important, not just for us politicians, but to all humankind. Democracy is the best regime where you can live. Democracy will be free to speak, to do politics, to choose who should plan our municipalities or our country. In democracy, we will have free press, we will have state of law, we will have respect for human rights. In democracy, it is possible to have a more inclusive society with more women participating in political decisions and involving more youth in our own parliaments. So it is very important, but we need to remember democracy is like a flower. We need to put water in every day. Only in this way, democracy will grow with more time. And so, it's important to know today, on this special day, that we should defend democracy always, every day of the year. And thank you so much. Thank you because India is the largest democracy of the world. You involve in politics more than 1 billion of citizens. With freedom, with the capacity to choose who they wish to run the country and their own citizen states. I felt during my visit to India a strong democracy, a very inclusive democracy, a dynamic democracy. Congratulations for that. What you are doing is very important, not just for you, not just for your country, but you are one example to the world. Congratulations. Today we celebrate
अब मैं जिस देश ने अभी पांचवा विश्व सम्मेलन आयोजित किया था और हमारी मेजबानी की थी, एक अद्भुत कार्यक्रम, दुनिया का सबसे सुंदर प्राकृतिक सौंदर्य वाला देश ऑस्ट्रेलिया के नेशनल असेंबली के अध्यक्ष श्री वोल्फगैंग सोवोटका जी को आग्रह करता हूं और उनको भारत की तरफ से भी बहुत बहुत साधुवाद देता हूं, बधाई देता हूं, जिन्होंने विश्व का बड़ा पीठासीन अधिकारी सम्मेलन कर एक नई मिसाइल कायम की।
थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर गिविंग मी द फ्लोर। Mr. Speaker, dear friend, President from the ITU, Pacheco, I think parliaments have a crucial role in strengthening democracy. First and most important issue is to support publicly and recently the Zimbabwe MP as an opinion leader. These people can be in disputes of expertise or constituency. Special assistance can be offered from our parliaments, from our parliamentary organization, for example, in the field of communication, and to improve his personal performance. Furthermore, a parliament per se can use its role in the political systems of our countries to highlight the necessity and importance of democracy and the processes. Parliaments represent every voter, therefore have a wider legitimacy as government. We should use this advantage in our daily work as presidents of parliaments. I would give an example from Austria, what we have done in the past. Austria's parliament has developed an educational branch called Democracy Workshop. A small group of pupils or other people can discuss with members of parliament or they get information how the law comes to the parliament, with scientists or of the Academy of Science.
I think parliaments should be an open space, and therefore we open our parliaments in special rooms, especially the restaurants for the common public. And so we try to bring the democracy next to people. And I think that could be a way in Austria to strengthen democracy for the next time. I want to thank you, Mr. Birla, for inviting me to this very important conference on the special day, the International Day of Democracy. I'm in Sweden, and I visit my colleague Norlin, and I joined the opening ceremony of the Swedish parliament. And you see that's also necessary in this time that the parliamentary diplomacy go forward. Therefore, many thanks, and I wish you a very successful conference on the Zoom meetings.
Thank you, Excellency.
Thank you, Excellency. मैं गुयाना नेशनल असेंबली के अध्यक्ष माननीय मंजूर नादिर जी से आग्रह करूंगा कि वह सभा को संबोधित करें।
Our host, His Excellency, the Speaker of the Lok Sabha, the Honorable Om Birla, all my fellow speakers of national assemblies, also all of the speakers of the assembly of the Indian parliaments, state parliaments, and local authorities who are gathered today. First, let me give you salutations on this International Day of Democracy, a day brought into existence in 2007, as we all know, after the resolution was passed in the UN General Assembly. Excellency Om Birla, I compliment you for organizing this session. It is important that we all bring our views to the table where democracy is concerned. We salute India its centenary celebrations with respect to democracy and your parliament. And it's an honor for us to have been invited to say a few words today. While Guyana is just a small country under 1 million people, it is as important to us as the largest democracy in the world, India, that this system of the people through their representatives elected at definite periods to run the affairs of the people, it is important that this system continue to perpetuate. Only last year, we saw Guyana going through tensions, convulsions, challenges to its democracy. A country where elections held on the 2nd of March, the results could not have been declared till the end of July, the first day of August. And this is not India, where you have to count tens of millions and hundreds of millions of votes, under 500,000 votes. So whether it's in one of the island countries of the Caribbean or the smallest nation, to have this concept of the of democracy entrenched, supported, is, in my view, the only path to human development and freedom for humanity. The only path. And regardless of what shining edifices and great infrastructure that a country may put up on show, if a person's spirit is chained, if a person's will cannot be expressed through that person's representative in a society, no one is free. And so Guyana stands in a unique place in South America as the only English-speaking country on the continent, but we are very well integrated in CARICOM, a 15-member community of nations comprising many island territories, 12 island territories. Many of those territories have very small voting population. But what we all do is cherish democracy. We know what it is to have your spirit free, to speak freely, and to go out at definite periods and choose your representatives. And India, being the largest democracy in the world, has blazed a path for all of us. Democracy, in my view, is always being challenged. And there are going to be hiccups. We saw only a few months ago the assassination of the president of Haiti in our region. In the past 40 years, we've seen an assault on the parliament in Trinidad and Tobago. We have seen the assassination of a minister and a minister in the government of Guyana. We have seen a coup in Grenada and a second subsequent coup. And anytime these challenges to democracy occur in our region, we fight very hard to restore it. And so I commend this opportunity to continue for all of us to express how strongly we feel about this principle. And we are very, very pleased to be part of your activity today in celebration of this.
Excellency, Maldives.
I now request Excellency Mohammad Nasheedji, Speaker of the People's Majlis of Maldives. It's a very matter of happiness that you have recuperated and you're discharging your responsibilities. It is a matter of happiness. I wish you better health. Everyone prayed for your good health. And we are all happy. I would now request Excellency Mohammad Nasheed to address this gathering.
Thank you very much, Honorable Speaker of Lok Sabha, Om Birla. Good morning, good afternoon to all the speakers. throughout the world. It gives me great pleasure to be speaking to this August gathering on the 100th anniversary of the All India Presiding Officers Conference. This is the 15th of September, and therefore we also celebrate the International Day of Democracy. The hasty rush out of Afghanistan, leaving the Afghan people to a group of people who came to power through the barrel of the gun, an unelected group of people, a group of people that have no respect for democracy, is certainly not reassuring. It is not reassuring to the people of Afghanistan, neither to South Asia or to the world. People in South Asia are bound to ask, people all over the world are bound to ask the question. And believe me, you, they do. What happened? Was that a massive failure of democracy? What happened to nation building in Afghanistan? Why did democracy not take root in Afghanistan? The view that it was because it is Afghanistan is extremely condescending, and I would say democracy and freedom is universal. The color of your skin or your race does not dictate the extent of pain. Torture is always painful. Hunger is always hard. Failure in Afghanistan certainly lies elsewhere. The people who occupied that country for 20 long years failed to construct functioning political parties. They failed to compose political manifestos. They failed to let people canvass for votes based on pledges to do good. They failed to run a free and fair election. They failed to build an election commission. They failed to establish a judiciary that will judge the fairness of an election. They failed to build an army that will protect the ballot. This, I believe, is why we primarily failed in Afghanistan. They failed to build a parliament. It was never because they were Afghans. I refuse to believe that democracy take root only if you are from a particular race. India, of course, is the shining example of that. The biggest democracy in the world. Today we celebrate 100 years of Indian Presiding Officers Conference. And another country in South Asia, Sri Lanka, has never transferred power other than through the ballot. Today, we must not lose faith. We must not give in. We must, as South Asians, as members of the democratic free world, as members of people who love freedom, we must not fail to continue our assistance in trying to build democracy in Afghanistan. We must assist the people of Afghanistan. There is more interest than ever before about issues related to democracy and good governance around the world. We cannot have effective, meaningful, good governance over the long term in the absence of democracy. It never works. But recent years have seen democracy under threat from a variety of quarters. The rise of affluence, authoritarian regimes, and the export across the world of the methods and technology of dictatorship best practices. More recently, the rise of the populist right and the authoritarian left also poses great dangers for existing democracies, relatives to the United States. The role of new technology, particularly social media, and its ability to spread misinformation has made many people lose trust in traditional institutions, the media, and chase conspiracy theories down the internet's many rabbit holes. The role of parliaments in upholding democracy could not, therefore, be more important as we see the threats to democracy grow all around us. Parliaments have a critical role to play. They fundamentally must faithfully represent the views of the electorate. To ensure governance by the people and for the people. At the same time, they must also respect and uphold constitutional order and ensure the views and wishes of the majority do not trample on the fundamental rights of minorities. One of those fundamental rights is freedom of speech, which is a keystone of democracy. Without this important freedom, many of our other freedoms fall away. A free society does not work unless people are allowed to think freely. And people often think by saying out loud their ideas and opinions, or writing about them online, or in the media. This must be protected at all costs. Democracy and the thought crime are fundamentally incompetent. Freedom of expression takes special significance for parliamentarians. It allows them to conduct with citizens, connect with citizens, raise their concerns, and denounce corruption or abuse. Parliamentarians must be allowed to do this freely, without fear of reproach. Parliament cannot fulfill its role in holding the executive to account. Parliamentarians have a responsibility to create and safeguard laws that protect freedom of speech for everyone else. And they may also pass additional laws, such as a right to information, that helps the general public to hold the government to account. Parliaments also have a crucial role in safeguarding media freedoms, ensuring journalists are not targeted for what they write, and that media outlets are free from government harassment. From my own personal experience, obviously there can be a huge step change in the way parliaments operate since the Maldives became a democracy in 2008. Prior to 2008, Maldives was a one-man authoritarian state, and any criticism of the government of President, whether it was by an MP or a citizen, invariably led to one place, a jail cell. I have spent many years in a Maldive prison cells precisely for calling the government to account while sitting as an MP in parliament. Since the Maldives' transition to democracy, things have improved to no end. But we still have issues, and Parliament must remain vigilant. Democracy is a process, not an end destination. We need only to look to the United States last year to see how quickly democracy can unravel and how close one of the world's oldest democracies was to falling prey to authoritarian rule. As a general rule, from my observation in the Maldives, government would always want shortcuts and supremacy. It doesn't matter if the government was democratically elected or not. Power tends to corrupt, and officials and ministers need to show quick results. My friend, Honorable Speaker of the Lok Sabha, thank you ever so much for inviting me
Thank you, Excellency.
And I am pleased to say
के महामहिम गंबो जव जडन सतत जी को आमंत्रित करता हूं अपने विचार व्यक्त करने के लिए.
President of the IPU, Your Excellency Mr. Om Birla, Speaker of the Lok Sabha, Honorable Speakers of Parliament, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to extend my heartfelt greetings and congratulations to you on the commemoration of the centennial anniversary of the All India Presiding Officers Conference, as well as the occasion of the International Day of Democracy. I believe today's gathering on this day dual celebrations making such an auspicious occasion the role of legislator in promoting effective and meaningful democracy is both truly noteworthy and timely event. Recently, during the 5th World Conference of Speakers of Parliament in Austria, I had the opportunity to meet with Your Excellency Mr. Om Birla, Speaker of the Lok Sabha, of the Republic of India, and I was delighted to have had the opportunity to hold a pleasant conversation with you, and I would like to reiterate the further strengthening of the friendly relations between our two countries, including the cooperation between our two legislative bodies. We attach great importance to the ever-growing development of bilateral relations with the Republic of India, the strategic partner and spiritual neighbor of Mongolia. It is gratifying to note that our country's long-standing friendly relations, which is based on common democratic values and unique spiritual and cultural ties, are expanding day by day. The development of democratic processes is significantly advancing across countries around the world, no matter their distinct cultural, ethnic, religious, political, and economic development characteristics. For instance, India remains one of the largest democracies, not only in the region, but across the global sphere. While successfully developing democracy in the region, Mongolia has become a clear example of vibrant democracy in this region. As a strong supporter of democratic governance around the world, and as a former presidency of Community of Democracies and the current member of state of its governing council, Mongolia is committed to contributing to the further strengthening of democracy, not only in the region, but also across the world. We are happy to engaging in active and open cooperation with the Republic of India and other countries in this area. The year of 2020 marked the 30th anniversary of the establishment of permanent parliament in Mongolia, among the Asian countries whose political systems have gradually changed since 1990. Mongolia's role as a model of democracy is connected to a greater extent by its parliamentary activities. As a parliamentary democracy, Mongolia respects the rule of law, human rights, and freedoms, and seeks to incorporate these values into every single legislation, and thus further strengthen its values and ideas through democracy. Parliament of Mongolia made amendments to the Constitution of Mongolia based on the people's will, Mongolian people's will, and started the process of legal reform. The sense of the constitutional amendment is to further reinforce democracy and human rights in Mongolia. During the autumn session of the parliament, commencing on October 1st, we will pay special attention to continuing our efforts to delivering the constitutional amendments and further intensifying our legal reform. This day is celebrated around the world as the International Day of Democracy, a day when both international community and countries of the path of democracy re-evaluate and assess its democratic achievements and shortcomings. It is also an opportunity to highlight the role of national parliaments in the democratic process and emphasize the significance of justice, peace, prosperity, and human rights. Once again, on the occasion of this significant day, I would like to congratulate you and wish you every success in your work in the line of democracy. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Excellency. मैं अब नामीबिया की नेशनल असेंबली के स्पीकर प्रोफेसर पीटर काटवा जावी से अपने विचार व्यक्त करने का आग्रह करता हूं।
Speaker on behalf of the Speaker of Docs Shamba, Honorable President of IPU, fellow speakers, distinguished invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to extend warm greetings from the Parliament of Namibia. As part of the family of the Inter-Parliamentary Union, IPU, we annually, on the 15th of September, with the rest of the world, observe the International Day of Democracy. I'm therefore honored to join you this morning, distinguished presiding officers across India and other invited speakers from other parts of the world, to acknowledge and to celebrate the efforts undertaken by our respective parliaments worldwide in achieving and upholding the principles of democracy. The International Day of Democracy annually presents us a renewed opportunity to review the state of democracy in the world. It goes without saying that values such as the respect for human rights, respect for the rule of law, conducting free, fair, and credible elections through universal suffrage are the backbones of any democratic state. Ladies and gentlemen, the preamble of the Namibian Constitution reads, "Whereas as we, the people of Namibia, desire to promote amongst us the dignity of individual and the unity of integrity of the Namibian nation amongst and in association with the nations of the world." That statement underscores Namibia's commitment to the cause and the achievement of democracy in our country, as well as to exercise peaceful coexistence with the rest of the world to enable democracy and the rule of law to reign supreme. Ladies and gentlemen, parliaments are the critical key players in the advancement and strengthening of democracy across the world. But it is equally so important that democracy is felt at grassroots in our own countries and not used as a means of meeting international standards. Parliaments is the representative of citizens' voices, and our mandate must ensure that those voices are protected in order for citizens to continue or being encouraged to undertake their civil obligations and responsibilities, thereby strengthening our nations in governance structures. This conference, therefore, presents us with an opportunity to learn from the rich experiences of fellow presiding officers on the state of parliamentary democracy in India and the world. As in all India Presiding Officers Conference marks 100 years since the existence, we will gladly learn and take note of some of the best achievements of this forum and use it to improve on aspects of democracy, especially in our young nations. It is important that parliaments across the world continue to advance the values of democracy for the betterment of our people. Having said that, I wish you, as one of the oldest democracies in the world, all the best as we continue to charter the better world for all our citizens. Thank you for having us. It's a great pleasure to be part of this important event. Thank you.
Thank you for having us. It's a great pleasure to be part of this important event. Thank you.
Thank you, Excellency. मैं एक्सलेंसी महामहिम श्रीलंका के स्पीकर महेंद्र यापा अभयवर्धना जी से आग्रह करता हूं कि वह अपने विचार व्यक्त करें।
गुड मॉर्निंग डीवी इस एक्सलेंसी ओम बिरला स्पीकर ऑफ लोकसभा योर एक्सलेंसी प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ आईटीयू Honorable speakers and presiding officers, distinguished guests and ladies and gentlemen, I am deeply honored and privileged to address this conference to mark centennial year of all India presiding officers conference. This is a very special day that we also commemorate the International Day of Democracy as declared by United Nations General Assembly in 2007. At the very inception, let me express my sincere gratitude for His Excellency Om Birla, Speaker of Lok Sabha, for inviting me to address this conference. The theme today is very much close to our hearts as presiding officers of parliaments. In India and Sri Lanka, parliamentary democracy is well established. Sri Lanka faced two insurrections and prolonged separatist war and even military coup attempt over years. Despite these serious challenges, we have been able to preserve parliamentary democracy. Sri Lanka's rich legislature has a long and somewhat checkered history that defined its formative years. It is the oldest parliament elected by universal adult franchise in Asia. As close neighbors, India and Sri Lanka share many common standards of connectivity. Both countries have an ancient history and rich heritage. The Commonwealth countries, our governing system, were greatly influenced by Westminster system. Our relationship encompasses many facets. Of course, Buddhism is the greatest blessing that we received from India. In fact, the Buddhist philosophy carried the way essence of democratic governance. In the modern era, the economic and democratic cooperation between two countries is significant, and Sri Narendra Modi, Prime Minister of India, addressed the Parliament of Sri Lanka on 13 March 2015. As the most important democratic neighbor of Sri Lanka and as the largest democracy in the world. How India's legislature functions in a multi-religious, multi-ethnic society offers many valuable lessons for not only for us, also as neighbors, but even to the scholars of democratic governance. Transparency and accountability are cornerstones of good democratic governance. And Sri Lanka Parliament has adopted a policy of open parliament with the intention of enhancing citizen participation and engagement in the parliamentary process. The initiative is expected to narrow the gap between the parliament and the citizens, making the representatives directly questionable and responsible to the public. After enactment of right of information bill, the Parliament of Sri Lanka took the decision to open sessions of committees on public accounts and public enterprises to the media and thereby to the public. It is a significant step towards strengthening parliamentary democracy system and will pave the way for greater transparency and accountability. Parliament of Sri Lanka has a vibrant committee system. Among many committees, the consultative committees play a key role in creating a forum and for the members of parliament and the cabinet of ministers to interact directly in addressing many relevant issues pertaining to their respective portfolios. The committee of selection at the commencement of every session of parliament appoints consultative committees for each ministry. The reports of the consultative committee are represented to the parliament. In addition, parliament has taken steps recently to meet the public through the newly established Department of Communication. It is expected to expand the knowledge on parliamentary process and its importance to uphold democracy among the population, particularly targeting the school children who are the future flag bearers of democracy. It may be relevant to note that impact of COVID-19 pandemic on the functioning of parliament. The parliament has continued with its usual sittings, even though the number of sitting days were curtailed to minimize the risk involved the members and the staff of parliament. However, through vaccination and application of strict health regulations, we have been able to ensure effective functioning and many committees meet virtually through online system, even though the House meets on its conventional way in the main chamber of the parliament. Before I conclude, let me mention few pertinent points in terms of fostering effective and meaningful democracy. Parliamentary democracy is not confined to periodic elections. It is a day-to-day continuation of consultative and transparent governance and ultimately ensure wisdom, equity, justice, prosperity and to all its citizens. Parliaments are for healthy debate, discussions and finally reaching the best possible agreement on issues. The ultimate measure of successful democracy is how countries, poorest, most helpless citizens are treated and benefited through the democratic process. People's representatives should focus more on improving the standards of living of all citizens in an equitable manner. Eradicating poverty, reducing economic disparities, and achieving overall development of a country should be the top priorities of all legislators. The parliament is in the position not only to keep the executive under constant vigil and scrutiny through its oversight mechanism, but also to guide with good advice to achieve the best possible result for its representatives. Questions, debates, advisory committees, watchdog committees, and no confidence motions can be mentioned as few such tools in the hands of the legislature to both assist and control the executive. The legislature also has an important role to play in eliminating corruption. Corruption contravenes the very principles of transparency, accountability, and equity that underpin democracy and it hampers the socio-economic development of all nations. Democracy requires the participation of all citizens. The parliaments are main mandate to deliver on justice, peace, development, and human rights. In this regard, prudent attention of citizens needs inclusiveness, accountability, and political tolerance should be ensured. The importance of 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development Goals should be highlighted for this purpose. Let me conclude this by saying that all legislators in our paramount duty to strengthen parliamentary democracy, sound economic programs for poverty elevation and development, peace, security, quality education, good health care, environmental protection are key features of true democracy. I wish fruitful deliberations and successful conclusion of this conference. Thank you very much.
Dhanyavad, Excellency. Thank you, Excellency. May I have जिम्बाब्वे नेशनल असेंबली के ऑनरेबल स्पीकर श्री जे एफ एन मुंडेडा जी को आग्रह करता हूं कि वह अपने विचार व्यक्त करें.
योर एक्सेलेंसी, थैंक यू. योर एक्सेलेंसी, द स्पीकर ऑफ द इंडियन पार्लियामेंट, Right Honorable Bila, Your Excellency, IPU President, Mr. Duarte Pacheco, dear colleagues, let me preface my brief remarks by extending my profound commendations to the Parliament of India for organizing this political engagement on the occasion of commemorating the International Day of Democracy, aptly themed the role of the legislature in fostering effective and meaningful democracy. This day comes against the backdrop of the vagaries and existential threats posed to our democracies by the invisible yet devastating hand of the COVID-19 pandemic. I am therefore emboldened by the belief that our convention here will clear the pathway towards fostering effective and meaningful democracy in our countries. Allow me from the onset to reminisce and call to mind the words of the eminent Indian jurist, economist, politician, and social reformer, B.R. Ambedkar, who opined that, and I quote, democracy is not a form of government, but a form of social organization, unquote. Rightly so, on this day that we commemorate democracy, we also ought to introspect on how we have adjudged the discourse on democracy within our different nations. Our observance of this day is reflective of Ambedkar's invisible conviction that we need to redefine the dogma of democracy. We ought not to continue viewing democracy as a form of government, but as a conduit through which we can reorganize our sometimes divided society through the representative institutions of our parliaments. It is potential that we view democracy not as a measure of development, but as the culvert through which we water the seeds of shared socio-economic growth and development. It is further critical, dear colleagues, that we also view democracy not as justice and the rule of law tenet, but the paradigm against which justice and supremacy of the law is attested. Essentially, in the words of John Rawls, an American political philosopher, democracy should be the means of guaranteeing justice as fairness. Further to that, it is indispensable that we move away from defining democracy as transparency and accountability, but as a framework that prescribes the best democratic practices towards attaining those two cardinal values. Our state institutions, ministries, departments, and agencies ought to affirm that true democracy rests on accountability and transparency in establishing who should govern the people and how that governance must ride on limited state power and authority. As Prime Minister Modi of India once opined that, and I quote him, good governance cannot remain merely a philosophy. Mere good governance is not enough. It has to be pro-people and proactive. Good governance is putting people at the center of the development process, unquote. True to this affirmation, it behoves parliamentarians in a democratic society that our legislative agenda is to ensure that it is pro-people, pro-poor, and inclusive in all the respects of human endeavor. Yet, dear colleagues, I cannot overemphasize the multiplicity of factors that have threatened democracy tenet globally. It is prominently axiomatic that the exigencies of the COVID-19 pandemic have redefined the democratic governance discourse almost in reverse gear of its attenuation. Worryingly, this time of crisis also gave rise to the threat of vaccine nationalism, where some of the privileged countries with the technology and research capacity manufactured vaccines primarily for their nationals, as opposed to sharing with less developed countries in this true spirit of multilateralism. To date, over 1.4 billion vaccines have been manufactured, but Africa has only received just slightly over 2% of those. We ought to ask ourselves if these are the ideals of the global democratic system that we all envisage and hanker after. It therefore behoves Parliament, as the epitome of democracy, to steer the transformative agenda of building back better and reclaiming the envisaged ideals of democracy in our societies. Our Parliament should ensure that measures taken against the spread of coronavirus are proportionate and do not infringe upon fundamental rights, the rule of law, and constitutionalism. Herein lies the bedrock of Parliament's oversight role in enhancing meaningful and effective democracy. It is therefore palpable that India has been one of the tested beacons of sustainable democracy, notwithstanding the fact that there is no universally accepted barometer by which one can measure the true scales of distinctive democracy. On that score, let our two legislatures of India and Zimbabwe, let alone others globally, continue to share and nurture best democratic practices through the unbroken fraternal umbilical cord of our historical antecedents, as inspired by the late charismatic Mahatma Gandhi, the founding father of Indian democracy. Long live democracy in the world. I thank you.
Democracy in the world. I thank you.
Thank you, Excellency. अब मैं भूटान के नेशनल असेंबली के डिप्टी स्पीकर तेंशो बांगबी जी को आग्रह करता हूं कि वो अपने विचार व्यक्त करें. मॉरिशस. मॉरिशस के डिप्टी स्पीकर माननीय मोहम्मद जाहिद नाजूर अली जी से अनुरोध करूंगा कि वह अपने विचार व्यक्त करें. डिप्टी स्पीकर मॉरिशस असेंबली. Speaker, Mauritius Assembly, Mohammed Jaid Nasur Ali Ji.
His Excellency, Sri Om Birla, Speaker of the Lok Sabha, the President of the IPU, distinguished presiding officers and deputy presiding officers, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the members of the National Assembly of Mauritius and in my own name, I convey to you the warmest greeting of the people of Mauritius. It is my singular honor and privilege as Deputy Speaker to address this conference today in context of the celebration of the International Democracy Day, which coincides with the centenarian of All India Conference of Presiding Officers. Allow me also to place on record my appreciation to the Speaker of the Lok Sabha, Sri Om Birla, for bringing together the presiding officers to this forum. Distinguished presiding officers, deputy presiding officers, ladies and gentlemen, I do not intend to explain democracy or the function of parliament. I shall, however, demonstrate how it works in Mauritius. Since its accession to independence more than half a century ago, Mauritius has a written constitution and has always demonstrated adherence to fundamental rights and freedom of its citizens for a harmonious society despite its multi-ethnicity. In Mauritius, the Constitution provides for the National Assembly to be renewed every 5 years through free and fair election. Based on the principle of separation of powers, our Parliament assume its role independently of the other arms of government. Our Parliament have full latitude within the parameters of standing orders and rule to play their role fully in exercising oversight over the executive. Inasmuch as democracy is not only about laws that are voted, but also how they are voted. There are three aspects which I would like to highlight about the Mauritian Parliament. Is the role of women is necessary, but is not only necessary, but also complementary to that of men in a vibrant democracy. The Mauritian Parliament has in 2016 set up a formal parliamentary gender caucus, regrouping members of parliament of both genders across party representation in the National Assembly to work for a common cause, that is to work for the promotion and attainment of gender equality. Secondly, with regard to youth, considering that youth will be called upon to play an important role in the future, a National Youth Parliament was launched in 2018 with a view to engaging the youth in the democratic process of the country. It would be important also for me to talk about the effect of COVID on the parliament. I'm pleased to inform you that this August gathering that the Mauritian Parliament has showed its resilience amid COVID-19 pandemic. Its structural changes have been brought promptly to the chambers, ensuring that all 70 MPs can attend and participate in parliamentary sitting to carry out its business of overseeing the action of the executive. Ladies and gentlemen, when it comes to democracy, you will agree with me that there is no room for complacency. I can reassure all of you that the Mauritian Parliament will continue in its endeavor in fostering effective and meaningful democracy. Before ending my speech, it will be very important for me to state out the role of the speakers. With your permission, I shall state it in Hindi, then I'll translate it in English. Hamara kaam desh ko chalana nahi hai, magar hamara dharm ye hai ke jo chala raha hai, uski hisab kitab rakhna. Translated as, it is not our job as president to run the country, but it is our duty to hold to account those who do. Let me take this opportunity to thank you very much for your kind attention. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Excellency. मित्रों विदेशों से हमारे सम्मेलन में कुछ और गणमान्य अतिथि जुड़े हुए हैं. भूटान नेशनल असेंबली के डिप्टी स्पीकर, केन्या के माननीय संसदगण, रशियन फेडरेशन के कुछ माननीय संसद सदस्य. मैं उन सब का भी हृदय से धन्यवाद करता हूँ. अब हमारे बीच में हमारे अपर हाउस के डिप्टी चेयरमैन श्री हरवंश जी से आग्रह करता हूँ कि वह आपको धन्यवाद देंगे.
Honorable presiding officers of parliament across the world and honorable IPU president, we are going to commence discussions in the conference being held to commemorate the centenary year of presiding officers conference in India.
Or exit.
If you wish,
as per your convenience.
Part in this program.
We meet in
or exit. It's as per your convenience. We meet in Austria and exchange our views on different issues, including COVID-19. On behalf of Indian Parliament, once again, I express my sincere thanks and gratitude. I thank you all for joining this conference. Thank you.
माननीय पीठासीन अधिकारीगण, आज हमारे साथ विश्व के कई पीठासीन अधिकारी भी जुड़े. उनको भी मैं पीठासीन अधिकारी सम्मेलन के अध्यक्ष होने के नाते धन्यवाद देता हूँ. आज भारत के पीठासीन अधिकारियों का सम्मेलन का शताब्दी वर्ष है. इसके लिए मैं आप सबको भी धन्यवाद देता हूं. पीठासीन अधिकारियों का पहला सम्मेलन वर्ष 1921 में शिमला में हुआ था. इस सम्मेलन को 100 साल पूरे होने जा रहे हैं. मुझे आशा है कि 100 साल के बाद फिर हम हिमालय के उस प्राकृतिक सौंदर्य हिमाचल प्रदेश के शिमला में मिलेंगे. इन 10 दशकों की यात्रा में हमने आज़ादी भी प्राप्त की और लोकतांत्रिक मूल्यों पर आधारित अपना संविधान भी बनाया. संविधान निर्माताओं ने लोगों की अपेक्षाएं और आकांक्षाओं के अनुरूप सबसे उपयुक्त संसदीय प्रणाली को अपनाया. लोकतंत्र की इस लंबी यात्रा में हमने अपने विचारों और अनुभव के माध्यम से लोकतंत्र को और मजबूत किया है और लोकतांत्रिक संस्थाओं को पारदर्शी और जवाबदेह बनाने के लिए निरंतर प्रयास भी किए हैं. पिछले 100 वर्षों के दौरान पीठासीन अधिकारियों के सम्मेलन में जो संकल्प और निर्णय लिए गए हैं, अब समय आ गया है कि हम उन संकल्पों और निर्णयों को विहार में लाएं और उनको एग्जीक्यूट करने की कार्य योजना भी बनाएं. माननीय पीठासीन अधिकारीगण, संसदीय लोकतंत्र की नींव निर्वाचित प्रतिनिधियों की जनता के प्रति जवाबदेही पर टिकी हुई है. विधानमंडल लोकतंत्र के ऐसे मंदिर हैं जिनके माध्यम से हम जन कल्याण के कार्य करने का प्रयास करते हैं. सर्वोच्च जनप्रति संस्थाएं होने के कारण हमसे ये अपेक्षा की जाती है कि देश में अन्य संस्थाओं और संगठनों के लिए हम आदर्श संस्थाओं के रूप में कार्य करें तथा कार्य अनुशासन और शालीनता के उच्चतम मापदंडों को बनाए रखें. किसी विधानमंडल की विशेषता उसके सदस्यों की भूमिका और आचरण से जुड़ी होती है। जनप्रतिनिधि होते के नाते उससे यह अपेक्षा की जाती है कि वे विधानमंडल के अंदर और बाहर शालीनता के उच्चतम मापदंडों का पालन करें। दुर्भाग्य से हाल के वर्षों में हमने देखा है कि जनप्रतिनिधियों के अशोभनीय व्यवहार की घटनाएं बढ़ती जा रही है, जिससे इन संस्थाओं की छवि धूमिल होती जा रही है। पीठासीन अधिकारी होने के नाते हमारी जिम्मेदारी है कि हमारे जनप्रतिनिधियों के व्यक्तिगत और सामूहिक आचरण के मापदंडों को उच्च बनाने के लिए हम किस प्रकार की योजना बना सकते हैं। इस बात का ध्यान रखना होगा कि हमारी लोकतांत्रिक संस्था हमारे संविधान में परिकल्पित व्यवस्था के अनुरूप कार्य करने में सक्षम हो। मैं सभी पीठासीन अधिकारियों से आग्रह करता हूं कि हम सामूहिक मिलकर इसकी कैसे योजना बना सकते हैं, इस पर विचार करने की आवश्यकता है। पीठासीन अधिक मेरे मन में कुछ विचार हैं, कुछ सुझाव भी है। मैं इस पीठासीन अधिकारी सम्मेलन के शताब्दी वर्ष और आज़ादी के अमृत महोत्सव के उपलक्ष में कुछ कार्यक्रम की योजना जो मेरे मन में विचारों में है, मैं आपके साथ साझा करना चाहता हूँ, ताकि हम सभी मिलकर अपने अपने विचार और सुझावों के आधार पर जब शिमला में व्यक्तिगत रूप से शीघ्र मिलेंगे, तब इन सब कार्यक्रमों को अंतिम स्वरूप दे सकें और उस पर आपके विचार भी बीच बीच में आते रहें, उस समय अंतिम स्वरूप देकर हम कार्यक्रम की योजना भी बना सकेंगे। मेरा पहला विचार था कि पिछले 100 वर्षों के अंदर जिसमें 81वां सम्मेलन हमारे हो चुके हैं, जो निर्णय हुए, जो विचार हुए, जो संकल्प लिए गए, उनको कैसे क्रियान्वयन कर सकते हैं, किसकी किस तरीके से उन विचारों संकल्पों को एग्जीक्यूट करने की योजना बना सकते हैं, इस पर भी हमें इस शताब्दी वर्ष पर विचार करने की आवश्यकता है। आज देश के अंदर संसद और विधानमंडलों में अनुशासन और शालीनता विषय पर भी हमें गंभीरता से विचार करना होगा। पहले भी इस विषय पर वर्ष 1992 में, 1997 में और 2001 में इस विषय पर सम्मेलन आयोजित हुए थे। इन सम्मेलनों के अंदर उस समय राज्यों के मुख्यमंत्री, प्रतिपक्ष के नेता, राज्यों के संसदीय कार्य मंत्री और सभी राजनीतिक दलों के नेताओं ने ऐसे सम्मेलनों में भाग लिया था और उसमें कुछ विचार संकल्प लिए गए थे। मुझे आशा है कि फिर 21 साल बाद हमें 2022 में बैठकर हमारी लोकतांत्रिक संस्थाओं में शालीनता और अनुशासन विषय पर फिर चर्चा करने की आवश्यकता है, ताकि हम कुछ ठोस कठोर निर्णय ले सकें। मेरा विचार है कि आज़ादी के 75 वर्ष पूर्ण होने जा रहे हैं। मेरा सुझाव है कि देश भर के सांसदों का और सभी राज्यों के विधायकों का एक व्यापक और बड़ा सम्मेलन हो, इस पर भी हम विचार कर सकते हैं। चौथा, आज़ादी के 75 वर्ष होने पर हमने IPG में निर्णय किया है कि लोकसभा और राज्यसभा के वर्तमान सांसद और पूर्व सांसद जिनकी उम्र 75 वर्ष से ऊपर हो चुकी है, जिनका एक लंबा दीर्घकालीन संसदीय अनुभव है, उनका भी सम्मेलन आयोजित किया जाए, इसी तरीके से आप राज्य में भी अपने अपने राज्य में जो 75 वर्ष की उम्र के विधायक और सांसद हुए हैं, चाहे वर्तमान और भूतपूर्व, उनके दीर्घ संसदीय अनुभव का लाभ लेकर सम्मेलन आयोजित करने की योजना बना सकते हैं। पांचवा, संसदीय व्यवस्था में लोक लेखा समिति एक महत्वपूर्ण समिति होती है जो संपूर्ण लेखा जोखा पर नियंत्रण करती है और शासन में पारदर्शिता लाती है। इस वर्ष 4 और 5 दिसंबर को लोक लेखा समिति ने निर्णय किया है कि इसका भी शताब्दी वर्ष 100 वर्ष पूरे होने जा रहे हैं, तो इस पर एक बड़ा आयोजन किया जाए। उसमें विश्व भर के लोक लेखा समिति के अध्यक्ष, राज्यों के पीठासीन अधिकारीगण, राज्यों के लोक लेखा समिति के अध्यक्ष और अन्य जिन पर आप सब लोग मिलकर विचार करेंगे, उनका भी एक सम्मेलन आयोजित करने का निर्णय हुआ है। मुझे आशा है इस पर भी आपके महत्वपूर्ण सुझाव मिलेंगे। इसी तरीके से देश की जो लोकतांत्रिक संस्थाएं हैं, विधानसभा और लोकसभा, उनके महिला और युवा सांसदों का भी एक सम्मेलन आयोजित किया जाए, उनके अनुभव विचारों को साझा किया जाए, ताकि आने वाली पीढ़ी भी हमारे संसदीय दीर्घकालिक अनुभव का लाभ प्राप्त कर सके। इस पर भी सम्मेलन करने पर भी विचार किया जा सकता है। सातवां, सभी राज्य विधानमंडल अपने अपने राज्यों में जो लोकतांत्रिक संस्थाएं हैं, ग्राम पंचायतें, नगरीय निकाय, इन संस्थाओं का सम्मेलन आयोजित कर सकते हैं। अभी लोकसभा की प्राइड संस्था ने 4 राज्यों के अंदर डेमोक्रेसी के सबसे लोअर पीरियड ग्राम पंचायतों के सम्मेलन आयोजित किए थे, जिनके अच्छे परिणाम आए हैं। मुझे आशा है राज्य विधानमंडल भी इस पर कार्य योजना बना सकता है, ताकि हम हर राज्य के अंदर सभी लोकतांत्रिक संस्थाओं के सम्मेलन कर और लोकतंत्र के सुदृढ़ीकरण और उनके सभा के कार्रवाई को किस तरीके से नियमित और सुचारू रूप से कर सकते हैं, इस पर भी विचार मंथन किया जा सकता है। मुझे आशा है कि आपके अमूल्य विचार और सुझाव शिमला सम्मेलन के पहले पीठासीन अधिकारी सम्मेलन के केंद्रीय कार्यालय जो संसद के अंदर है, उसमें समय समय पर आपके सुझाव आते रहेंगे, और जब भी आप दिल्ली आएँ तब आपके कक्ष में जरूर आएँ, ताकि आपका विचार विमर्श कर चलता रहे और आपके विचार अनुभव का लाभ सभी को मिल सके। मैं आपसे इस विषय पर भी सुझाव आमंत्रित करता हूँ, और हम सब जब शीघ्र ही शताब्दी वर्ष पे सम्मेलन पे मिलेंगे, तब इन विचारों को अंतिम स्वरूप देंगे, ताकि एक आज़ादी के 75 वर्ष होने पर और हमारे सम्मेलन के 100 वर्ष होने पर एक व्यापक कार्य योजना 2 वर्ष की बना सकें। आप सभी को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। असम विधानसभा हिमाचल के स्पीकर को एक अलग कार्यक्रम में जाना है, इसलिए मैं सबसे पहले हिमाचल के स्पीकर साहब से आग्रह करता हूं कि वह अपने विचार व्यक्त करें। श्री विपिन सिंह परमार जी।
मुख्य रूप से उपस्थित हमारे मार्गदर्शक, प्रेरणा स्रोत एवं हमारे आदरणीय लोकसभा के स्पीकर श्री ओम बिरला जी,
श्री ओम बिरला जी,
हिंदुस्तान के अलग अलग प्रांतों से इस वर्चुअल सम्मेलन में जुड़े हुए माननीय स्पीकर, पीठासीन अधिकारी, विभिन्न देशों से इस सम्मेलन में जुड़े हुए स्पीकर साहिबान, उपस्थित महानुभाव, मुझे ये बताते हुए प्रसन्नता हो रही है, आज से 100 वर्ष पहले पूरे देश के पीठासीन अधिकारियों का पहला सम्मेलन
14-16 September 1921
यही शिमला में आयोजित हुआ था। इसलिए ये शताब्दी वर्ष के रूप में भी आयोजित हो रहा है। मुझे इस बात का गर्व है कि जहां से मैं वर्चुअली सभी से जुड़ा हूं, यही पर 100 वर्ष पहले पूरे देश के पीठासीन अधिकारियों को यहाँ इकट्ठा होने का मौका और लोकतंत्र के ऊपर चर्चा करने का सौभाग्य प्राप्त
हुआ।
हिमाचल प्रदेश में समय समय पर पीठासीन अधिकारियों के सम्मेलन होते रहे।
were held in Himachal Pradesh from time to time.
वर्ष 1921